I know.
Just to let you all know that I had a distant cousin who just passed away from the COVID-19. She was in a nursing home. I'm not sure where. She was kind of estranged from the family, but I just got word this morning. So.
Sorry, buddy.
Sorry about that.
Here in Maryland?
I'm not sure where she was. I know my cousins were taking care of all that, but I mean, I haven't seen her for probably 50 years, so I don't know. She was a lot younger. She's had a lot of help.
Uh-oh. Oh, there they are.
I don't know where she's going to pop up.
It's a photo bomb.
She was in the second row, now she's in the top row. Oh, look, he thought a bomb too.
That was nice.
Morning, Nicole.
Hi.
Morning.
Hello. Good morning.
Hey, Nicole.
Hello.
Good morning, this is Ophelia.
Hey, Ophelia.
Ophelia.
Is on here. Joanne's on here, but she's muted out.
Hey, Mark. Mixed them in with my chicken salad for lunch.
Hi, Mark.
Just
eat some separate.
Yeah.
Hi, Amber.
Let's mess on.
Bacon piece on the inside.
That's what they call off.
Hey, Lyndon, is your mom listening?
Yes, she's listening in. She yelled out hello to everyone last week. I don't know if you heard her, but she's here.
Good morning.
Yeah, I heard her last week.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning, Sarah.
By the way, today is Larry Sr.'s birthday, for those of you who want to harass him.
All right.
All right, then.
Hey to Larry.
65.
Yeah. Oh, that's so
65, man. That's terrible.
Well, for those of us still younger than him, it is terrible.
Isn't that everybody in the world?
No, not them either.
It used to seem old.
Yeah, didn't it?
Yeah.
It still does.
Is Sarah on here? Did she get on?
Yeah.
I don't
know
this number.
There he goes.
Oh, Patricia.
Green.
I'm sure you can, but probably not.
Hey, Eddie, good to see you. Me too. How are you?
Thank you.
You get yourself staying really still.
Yeah.
While I have the opportunity,
it's unstable.
Okay. I want to thank everybody for all your sentiments on Facebook. Thank you very much.
Your mom was a cool lady.
Thinking about her a lot.
Yeah, we'll miss her smile.
I love the way she used to clap when we sang in gospel choir.
Sorry, Beto was sad.
We're missing our best groupie.
I know everybody told me that they always look at her to see how they were doing.
That's how she was laughing and smiling. Right. That was good.
The worst part about directing, I could never watch her because she was always so joyful.
Yeah.
Well, she knew the Wedding Crashers.
Yes, she did.
Yeah, we were having a discussion out in the hall one day about the movie, and we came up with one of the names, and we got sort of hung up on the other one, and she's just sitting here, and all of a sudden she blurts out the other name. We're going, where in the world did that come from?
That's happened another time.
Morning, Sandra.
Thanks. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Sandy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
One minute for church, folks.
You see your face, right?
I'm here.
Do I have other people on here too?
Oh,
I guess you can make it smaller.
Let me hear it, y'all.
See everyone. I'm not sure how to do that.
Is there a limited number of people that can be on at any
up
given
to 100.
Time?
Up to 100. We can get to 100.
Be your friends.
Wow. Norma, I think the number's pretty high.
Yeah, 100.
We're up to 100?
No, we can get there.
30, I see 32.
Right here.
Yeah, which is good.
But that's not counting double people.
That's not bad.
But
oh, you mean like Carol and Jim?
Yeah.
Double.
Hey, Patty.
Hi, how are you?
Okay.
Yes, I guess. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wonderful. All right. If you're all ready, I'm going to go ahead and mute all. Before I do that, do we have Rita Brooks on the call?
Yes.
Yay, wonderful. Get ready, Rita, because I'm going to highlight you in the announcements, and I'm going to let you go ahead and make that announcement in just a second, okay? All right, here we go. All right. So I want to thank you for joining us here this morning, and I pray that everybody's hanging in there. We're doing pretty good at the Dominguez McCubbin residence. So obviously any parents that are joining us this morning are really feeling it, but at the same time, I think we've all really felt like it's been kind of a dream come true to be able to spend so much time with our kids, but especially those of us with grandparents in the picture are very thankful to grandparents. So a little bit of a shout out there to Bruce and Pat McCubbin, and our thanks for giving us a little bit of a respite, 24-hour respite over the weekend. Abe enjoyed his time with his grandparents, we'll just say that. We're here all together because we need each other. And we need God. Things are tough and we're doing our best to get through it. And yet we're aware that so many simply aren't doing it. If you want to stress yourself out today, feel free to peruse all the numerous announcements about rising death tolls and rising cases and all those things. And if the virus hasn't touched your life in some way beyond, of course, the quarantine, you're lucky. But many of us here do know many folks who have experienced, it could be the loss of loved ones, it could be folks waiting on test results. We need each other, and we need each other to be a support, a shoulder to lean on and to cry on. If you haven't done it already, take a moment to pray for people who are being affected by this plague, this terrible, terrible illness, and particularly for those who continue to work on the front lines of this thing, all our essential workers, healthcare workers, anyone that has to soldier up to help us out, to help get us through this thing. We're living into a new order, and nobody knows what's going to be waiting for us on the other end of this thing, whenever these restrictions are lifted or whatever. But pray if you haven't been, and I'm sure all of you have been, but pray if you haven't been, pray fervently to the Lord for relief and for mercy. God laments every life that is missing. I can't stress that enough. The way that some people talk these days, it minimizes life. But for the Christian acknowledges that every life that is gone from this earth is missed by God and is valued by God. And Christians everywhere are being called to do whatever we can to serve. So I hope that God would grant you inspiration today to determine how you can help. And many of you already are. Our order of worship was sent out by email. An abridged version is available on the website, milfordmillchurch.org, under home worship.
If you're joining by phone and you don't have the ability to find a bulletin electronically, please, again, I've always mentioned this, we're trying to make sure that everybody has the ability to have a good worship service using this Zoom platform. Please call the church office, leave a message, let us know, and I can either mail you one or I can deliver one to you during the week. I want to thank anyone, as I have every single week since this crisis began. Thank you to anyone that has helped someone find their way here to us this morning. I want to thank you for taking the time to help someone connect with their faith family and particularly with Jesus. You may not think you did much by doing so, but for some, this is the only form of psychological and spiritual support they may have. So kudos to you for helping with that. Every single person can do something, even if it's just inviting someone to join a Zoom call on a Sunday morning. The church council has been working through a phone tree to help us stay connected, and they're continuing to contact as many people in our church family. If you haven't yet received a call and you would like to, please get in touch with Beth Sweet. She's our church council chair and coordinator of the phone tree. And the easiest way to do that is just to call the church, leave a message. We'll make sure that she gets the message with your contact information. The hymns found in the order of worship email contain YouTube links. When we come to a hymn in the order of worship, I'll perform a screen share for those of you with the Zoom client that'll allow you to hear the hymn. You can also hear it over the phone. And if you're joining by computer, tablet, smartphone, you'll see that video as well. I have a really decent setup here, but I can't vouch for the quality of the audio or video just because of the way internet connections work. So feel free to use the YouTube link to watch the video yourself if you prefer. Now, as our church tends to follow a more traditional style of worship, we often use call and response type prayers and litanies, which is why I'll mute everyone in the session during worship and at the beginning of worship. There are delays in speech that happen in virtual conferencing that some might find disorienting if we go through the spoken parts of the service together unmuted. So that's why you've been muted. Following worship, I'll unmute everyone, and I've really come to enjoy that time in the service. I call it the cacophony of saints. It's very loud with everybody saying hello and catching up, but it's pretty awesome. There is really nothing like it. It's the closest thing we have to a coffee or fellowship hour, which can be very daunting to folks who maybe like myself are a little more antisocial or maybe introverted or just find interactions intimidating. But here you've got everyone front and center. You don't have to work to get people's attention. They're right there in front of you. You can just give your name, say hello, maybe lift up a prayer concern if you really want to. And you can also use the chat function of the Zoom client to introduce yourself if that's not your speed. Speaking of prayers, if you have any prayer requests, we'll be taking those after the sermon and we'll be lifting them up in prayer. To do so, please go ahead and if you're on the Zoom client, type those into the chat function, and you can do that at any time during worship, by the way. Some of you, I think I might have heard some prayer requests lifted. Please take that time to lift those up as well for the benefit of the body, so we might all be in prayer. You can also text prayer requests to me if you don't have access to the Zoom client. You can text them at 202-579-9578. That's 202-579-9578. I'll repeat that again at the prayer time. So I just want to highlight three announcements before we begin. All three are in the announcement section of your bulletin. The first is to invite all of you to join us for our monthly church council meeting at 7 p.m. on Wednesday. You can use the exact same details that got you into worship this morning to join the meeting. On Thursday, our district superintendent is convening a special charge conference that you are, again, all invited to attend. That's at 7 p.m. Using the same details. Now, Rita, now's your time to shine. Please let everyone know about our graduates.
I would like to celebrate our graduates in some way. If I could get a list of the graduates. I have a tentative list. I've only had four people respond, one from the bulletin, one because I called and one from my text messages. But please let me know who they are. I do want to honor them in some way. Thank you.
All righty. Thank you so much, Rita. All right, so let me go ahead and perform our screen share so we can sing together our opening hymn. All right, one moment, please. Bear with me, thank you. Alrighty, and our first hymn will be Up From the Grave He Arose. Sorry, folks, having a little bit of technical difficulties here. One moment. All right, here we go. Can you give me a thumbs up if you're hearing the audio? Excellent, thank you.
Though in the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign.
Amen. All right, you should have your opening prayer there before you. Let's go ahead and join in it together. Eternal God, rock and refuge, with roots grown old in the earth, riverbeds run dry, and flowers withered in the field, we wait for revival and release. We experienced your resurrection, but we are still stuck in a Good Friday time. Forgive us for not celebrating your resurrection fully and living as resurrection people. Abide with us until we come alive in the sunrise of your glory. Amen. All right, let me go ahead and cue up our children's message. One moment.
Hi, and welcome to Children's Time today. Today, we're going to be talking about the ways that we take care of ourselves. So what do you have in your hand, Abe?
A toothbrush,
and what do we put on that?
Strawberry
toothpaste, right? And we
brush my teeth.
Brush your teeth, and that's a way to keep your teeth nice and clean and healthy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let me do it.
Yeah, we're gonna do it. We'll do it later. Can you put that down for me? Thank you. All right. What is this?
Lotion.
Not lotion. It's what do you use in the bathtub?
Soap.
So, very good. And we use it to get clean,
on
right?
On my belly, too.
On your belly?
On my back.
And on your back? Where else? Can we put it on your hair?
Yeah.
Yeah, to clean.
A comb brush.
A comb brush, yes, a comb. And what do we do with a comb?
Brush my hair.
Brush your hair? Do you want to show me how you brush your hair? Oh, good work.
That.
Yeah. And we do that? To make our hair look pretty. Thank you. And then what do we normally put in here?
Water.
Water, right. And we do that? Yeah, I don't think there's any in there right now. Good job. Thanks. So we put water in there to take care of our bodies so we can stay hydrated.
And drink it.
And what is that?
Applesauce.
Applesauce. And do we eat that when we get hungry?
Yep.
So we have to take care of our bodies, right, by taking care of the parts that are to eat and drink, right? We eat and drink these things so that way we can feel good and take care of ourselves. And we do things to take care of our hygiene, to take care of our bodies on the outside. But did you know that in the Bible, it says to make yourself into a spiritual house, to take care of your body and make it into a temple for God? Yeah, and what are some of the ways that we can do that? Do you think, what do we do at nighttime? We pray, right? Yeah, we pray and we talk to God and we read our Bibles, right? We read about God, that's right. And do we ever tell people about God?
Nope.
Or invite them to church?
Yeah, I'm calling my
phone. Here, buddy, come here, I need your help. So, come here. So we do these things to take care of our bodies on the inside and on the outside.
I hurt.
You hurt?
What is that?
When we hurt, sometimes we go to the doctor to take care of our bodies too. But God tells us to take care of our bodies both physically and spiritually so that we can be strong for God. So sometimes we do things like this to take care of our bodies, to be strong on the outside, but we also pray and read the Bible so we can be strong on the inside and strong and spiritual for God and make ourselves into a temple for God. Thanks for joining us.
No Abes were harmed in the making of this video. that was an adventure. It's always fun to do those with him. All right, we move now to our time of collecting our tithes and our offerings. Please note in the worship email, there was some information about how you can give. So there's a link to our electronic giving portal. It takes you directly to the link that can actually be found on our website at the very bottom of the homepage under links. But you can also use the, you can just click here on the worship email. If you use PayPal, you can send your offering to mmumc@aol.com, which is our former email address. Please note that, as usual, PayPal usually takes out like a service fee from your donation. I'm not actually sure exactly what percentage it is, but it's usually like 2-3%. You can also mail your offering to the church, and we thank you very much for helping us to fund the ministry of Milford Mill United Methodist Church. So at this time, I'll go ahead and give us a moment to do that, and I'll play our offertory. It's Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart. One moment, please. Did you know that since this whole thing began, our counters have faithfully been coming in each and every week to count our offering? I'd like you at some point to give thanks to our counters for their continued dedication in making sure that all of your donations are counted and recorded. And to anyone that continues to give, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. All right, one moment. There we go. Okay, so we're going to move now to our scripture for today. One moment. Oh, I'm sorry. We have a hymn. Let me go ahead and cue that up for us. The hymn is Christ Is Made the Sure Foundation. So one moment for that, please. Oh, that's right. Okay. Let me go ahead and cue up our doxology, actually. Let's sing together.
Below, praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. Yeah, this is very difficult, by the way, when you get a lot of, because, you know, during the service, I get a lot of notifications and different things from people with different comments and all that kind of stuff. And it's wonderful to be able to engage with you guys that way. But everything's kind of like one step at a time. So thank you for bearing with me as we explore this new technology. So let's now move to our hymn, Christ Has Made the Sure Foundation. One moment. Amen. All right, so now go ahead. We'll go ahead and move to our scripture passage. I'm going to go ahead and put that up on the screen for you guys so that you can have it right there before you. All right, and that's going to be, since we've been following 1 Peter this whole time, this is going to be 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 through 10. One moment. All right. So, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, then, who believe, he is precious, but those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Let God's people say, amen. All right, so today's sermon is called Living Stone. And I wanted to start by quoting an article from the blog and magazine Christian Century that in turn is quoting the famous Lutheran theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So Bonhoeffer writes, "A young girl stands before her classmates and teacher. Her teacher has chosen to be cruel. 'Is it true,' asks the teacher with a sneer, 'that your father is a drunkard?' The girl is well aware that her father comes home very late at night. She also knows the condition he is in when he does finally come home. And yet she responds flatly, 'No,' she says, 'my father is not a drunkard.'" So Bonhoeffer uses this example to ask the question, what does it mean to tell the truth? What are we to make of this girl who brazenly refutes an indisputable fact? This is being quoted from the article. For Bonhoeffer, the answer is clear. The girl did not lie, nor is she deceiving herself. She spoke a truth that was deeper than what her teacher or classmates could understand or could grasp. So deeper truths, they can't be reached if the one trying to reach them is predisposed to accept reality on a surface level, not really diving deep beneath the surface, or maybe predisposed to pluck circumstances from one moment in time without heeding any context. Someone can have that predisposition for one reason or another. They may have gone through life and found themselves to be unable to trust people for very long, or maybe not at all because of things that happened in their life. It's difficult to say, really, but it's definitely something that you learn. And unfortunately, this predisposition has always led to things like prejudice, the ease with which people are sort of shoved by others to the margins of society. I think it's what's led to some referring to coronavirus, for example, as a foreign or Chinese disease, which in the strictest sense is true. But saying that really fails to provide any real comfort or even a solution to our predicament. Certainly, Chinese officials, for example, you may have read in the news that they withheld information and we didn't get the whole picture from them. Absolutely, you know, and folks should be held accountable for that. But the girl that that Dietrich Bonhoeffer references, she speaks truth to her teacher and her classmates. Yes, acknowledging that her father does drink, but she spoke out of her experience of her father. This was a man that always showed her love and never once caused her harm. For her, that love shines out more than his obvious drinking problem. So it can be frightfully easy to thrust people into the margins of our lives. Most troublingly for Christians, when you consider the history of Christianity over the ages, this religion of ours took its first steps in the teachings and example, of course, of Jesus of Nazareth, whose areas of focus were primarily the relationship between the rich and the poor. And for more than 400 years, Christian communities lived on the margins of society. They were rejected, I mean, through and through, by both the faith system that birthed them, what we now call Judaism, and particularly by secular society that was being ruled by Roman conventions. So the author of 1 Peter is writing this letter to a community that is scattered around in the northwest corner of Asia Minor. That is what we now call Turkey, where Paul made a lot of his missionary journeys, and the Armenian highlands. It's an area that has a rich history before and after the Roman Empire. Did you know, for example, that the famed city of Troy and the site of the Trojan War was located there? Anyone see that movie with Brad Pitt and Eric Bana? Raise your hand if you did. A lot of people love that movie, especially younger people, kind of romanticized. Under Roman rule, the area became modernized by ancient standards. So roads were built over the countryside. The cities that were located there, they grew, they prospered. Prior to that, it was a lot of countryside, a lot of wilderness. When the Romans were overthrown, the Byzantine Empire, which was a Christian empire, became the seat of power in the region. The Turkey that we know now arose when Islamic caliphates, that's their form of governance at that time, they conquered the area, and then they were conquered in turn by the Seljuk Turks. Now, Islam was to remain the primary religion of the region from those days forward. The Turks ruled until the days of the Ottoman Empire. You may have heard that before. And when that collapsed after World War I, the Turkish War of Independence against the Allied occupation led to what we now know as the Republic of Turkey. Now, you may have learned all about this in school, but if you received the education that I did, it might have been a single chapter of a long-forgotten history book. There's a point to this history lesson. The point is that this region, which is so full of history, economic, intellectual achievement, has always been thrust to the margins by world powers. And yet so much of how we have come to understand the world and ourselves, so much of our knowledge has been influenced by the people that lived and toiled in this area. So returning to the Christian community that 1 Peter was written to, the people of Asia Minor were technically part of the Roman Empire, but they were really far from the seat of power. Modern society isn't really organized the way these ancient societies were, but if you want to try to understand who these people were, how they were perceived, you can kind of think of them the way that we think about backwoods people, you know, hillbillies, the way lots of folks deride people that live in Appalachia, for example. These were the ones that were the brunt of all the jokes of cosmopolitan society, if they were even thought of at all. I mean, most of the time they were forgotten. And if a foreign empire tried to conquer them, Rome didn't deem them worthy of defense. They were the first in line to fall. Generations of people were born and died in the region with all of this in mind. I mean, not exactly helpful to the self-esteem, you know? So that's why I love the letters of 1 Peter. This is why I love that they were included in the Bible. I mean, a book known throughout the world. These letters have influenced the faith of billions of people throughout our history. They've offered light in darkness, hope, and inspiration. I think this is the work of God, brothers and sisters, the way that God sweeps up both those who think they're worth something and those who have been told their whole lives through that they aren't worth anything and can use both to do incredible things. Praise be to God. Look at the way that the author of 1 Peter refers to them. So he heaps up high honor and praise. He uses the kind of words normally used to describe the Roman elite. This author knows that God has maybe sees a deeper truth in these people than others might see in them, people that don't know them, or that they see perhaps in themselves too. I mean, isn't that just like God? Sometimes we can get so close to a situation or so completely self-absorbed that we can't reflect on it well. Like an auto mechanic, for example, that lets a concerning noise go for too long because they know they can fix it. And then one day it wrecks the transmission, you know? Sometimes others see things in us more clearly than we see them ourselves. And it takes a great deal of emotional intelligence to recognize these things and accept the perspective that's been offered to us. The author of 1 Peter sees something special in the people everyone loves to hate. They aren't worthless to God. They're a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. This is the deeper truth that Christ, the living stone, sees in the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, the one that judges the thoughts and intentions of the heart, as Scripture says. The author uses the same term, the living stone, to describe these people. He puts them on the same conceptual level as Jesus Christ himself. Like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house. What a good word for us to hear as a community thrust from what we thought was our spiritual home, a building that currently sits empty. And yet God fills our hearts in a new way, maybe a strange way, and beckons us into a new way of living, one that we can't or won't understand yet. But God knew was waiting for us from the start. I mean, do you think that God, who is so good, didn't also think to provide us with the means to live into this new world, as God did through Christ that rose from the dead, that pushed the disciples out of their hiding after he died on the cross and then appeared before them, that sent people out into countries that spoke different languages, ate different foods, lived so differently than what the missionaries were used to? But to see all of this as a blessing, because it was hard work, to see it all as a blessing, there's a test involved. Scripture says it. You have to taste and see that the Lord is good. The author puts it like this: long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Do you know that the Lord is good? Have you accepted that into your heart? Don't answer so quickly. Don't go just to the first immediate thing. I mean, that might just be years and years of repetition. And in many cases, if we're really being honest, depending on our faith formation, brainwashing. I mean, with enough repetition and social pressure, you could be led to believe anything. Have you tasted that the Lord is good? Who gave you the life you led before this mess that we're in? Who has given you the life that you now lead? Did you earn it? Or was it provided to you? One of the reasons why Jesus said that it was easier to put a camel through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven was because wealth on the surface level, seems to be an earned thing that benefits the one that earned it. there's never really another purpose to it, no matter how much you nuance it, unless you start to give it away. That's what wealth is for. If you're used to thinking of yourself as self-made, chances are good that you may not understand God as provider. I mean, someone that has been thrust to the margins understands that concept inherently, even if they didn't really know that it was God, this idea of God as provider. Maybe they'll describe it as luck or chance when things seem to work out for them, but it's always something beyond them, you know, something they can't really control, which I find sad, because truthfully, it just betrays a lack of self-esteem and a knowledge of the worth that God assigns to every single person. If you're living well, it can be really hard to accept the notion that you're not responsible for your life or successes. I mean, you may convince yourself that there's something unique about you that granted you success. But this perspective discounts the idea that God is a provider to everyone. If you've been struggling your whole life long, or maybe you just perceive this to be the way that things tend to work out for you, you might also think that you're unique in your life's ability to go bad. I've known a lot of people like that. They have a very pessimistic view of the world. Folks just like that will never know God as provider unless they're willing to let that perspective go. Because if you can't let it go, you've already prejudiced yourself against God's provision. You won't even be able to see how God blesses your life every single moment of the day. There's no room for faith or God in either of these perspectives, because the Lord will always leave a bad taste in the mouth in both cases. In one, the Lord asks too much. In the other, too little. But both are subjective, rooted in the lens that only sin can provide. Both have placed a higher value on their perspective of life, the world, even God, than anyone else's perspective. Christianity is worthless to folks like these because the Christian perspective is a completely different set of values than what the rest of the world deems valuable. A person's worth isn't defined in this perspective by success in occupation, accrued wealth, status, access to healthcare, vehicles, property, clothing, education, or whether they eat top ramen and PBJs each day or haute cuisine. Those willing to let go of their perspective in favor of God's become living monuments of God's power, authority, and especially God's grace. I mean, believe it or not, every single person is a stone in the house that the good Lord is building, because our Savior, believe it or not, is working to redeem all of us. But the ones that hold it all up, hold it together, those are the living stones. You probably already know people just like that. You know, people that they just seem to radiate God's love. Here's a for example. One of the reasons that we remember our saints each year on All Saints Sunday is to remind ourselves that God has put these living stones right in our midst. They're our best teachers. They make us better by association. They're the ones that summon our better angels and remind us that no matter how far we may fall, we can always find our way back through the love of Christ. My wife once preached a sermon on this very subject. I love to hear her preach. She's actually one of the few pastors I know that I love to hear preach. When dealing with a particularly difficult church, she preached on the passage that we're going through today. And she said, brothers and sisters were called to be living stones, not boulders. Because, you know, boulders, they drag us down, right? They put things out of balance. They take up a lot of room. They crush everything beneath them. They can't help but throw their weight around. It's their nature. And yet, God can use even these to fortify the heavenly home. Boulders make for very strong walls. They're big, they're thick. But alone, in isolation, they're not walls themselves. They might be big, but they need a lot of other rocks to make a good wall. And when used the right way by the builder, they can support an awful lot of weight, which tells me that there is hope for anyone in God's sight. I should know. I consider myself to be a boulder. So praise be to God for the mercy that we're shown and for demanding more from us than we demand from ourselves. Alleluia and amen. All right, let's move to our prayer of confession. You should have that before you. I'll go ahead and perform a screen share again so that you can have that there. One moment. And it's right here. All right, let us pray. We confess that sometimes we have covered our ears so we cannot hear your word of judgment, Holy God. We seek to isolate ourselves from a world in pain. And so we become enemies of Christ, who identified with the poor, needy, and oppressed. We reject the one you sent as the way, truth, and life. We fail to pray as Jesus did, trusting that you hear and respond. O God, deliver us from ourselves. Amen. You were chosen to proclaim the mighty acts of the one who called you out of darkness into the Lord's light. Rejoice, you have received the mercy of the Lord. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God, and amen. All right. So at this time, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. So if you would like to lift a prayer concern, why don't you go ahead and you can, if you're on the Zoom client, you can look for the chat function at the bottom of the screen there, and you can type any concerns into the chat client. You can also text them to me. I've received a number of them already. To 202-579-9578. Again, that's 202-579-9578. I'm going to allow just a few minutes for those to trickle in, and then I'll read them aloud. And by the way, if you wanted them to just be kept private, please be sure to let me know in your message that you want them private. I'm going to play a little music for you to listen to while that goes on.
Just as I am. with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come.
All right, you can continue to share those requests. I'm going to go ahead and begin here. Give me one moment to scroll to the top. All right, if you're on the Zoom client, of course, you'll see these pop up in your chat window. But for the benefit of those on the phone, let me go ahead and read these aloud. From Sabrina Cordova, please continue to pray for Button and Belle, my granddaughter and her fiance. He tested positive and Belle will get her test results today. They are 22 and 21 and work in a retirement home. They are young heroes, and yes, indeed they are. Thank you all for your prayers. They are blessed with no symptoms. Praise be the Lord. All right, from Noel Brickman Williams, please pray for both Wayne and I. Wayne fell out of bed last night. He has a headache at the back of his head. Otherwise, he's fine. My cough variant asthma is acting up. Have a change in meds and getting better to see pulmonologist for following up pulmonary function. My mood is better on new medication. Amen. Amen. From Debbie, please continue to pray for my teacher friend Dawn, who's been diagnosed with the most aggressive form of ALS. She adopted a little boy from Africa where she volunteered in an orphanage there. Benjamin is now 9, and Dawn always says that he found her. She's very weak and will be moving in with her sister, who will formally adopt Benjamin. Dawn and Benjamin are a team, and she's heartbroken. She'll not be able to see him grow and blossom. Thanks to all who love her. She is a true gem on this earth and has brought joy and awareness of our earth's beauty, as she was an outdoor science teacher. And please keep her in prayer. All right. From Sandy Harley, pray for our first responders who are on the front line fighting the illness of fighting this virus, for our medical providers, EMTs, police officers, bus drivers, sanitation workers, store clerks, essential workers who work for places like Amazon and FedEx and UPS. More importantly, pray for the families and individuals that have lost loved ones, but not only here in our country, but around the world, and of course for the vulnerable, for the elderly, people with pre-existing conditions who are most vulnerable to the virus. And of course, that hate and selfishness be removed from our communities, that those who would rush to reopen our economies, that would put, that they would put health over our economics, right? Let's pray for civic and elected officials, of course, who continue to face these tough decisions, that they might have spiritual counseling, we'll put it that way, and of course related to the protests, armed or otherwise, that continue to go on, that there be peace there. From Robin Trenner, my daughter-in-law has been exposed. Please pray for her health. It was not unexpected. She is a nurse practitioner. Amen. From Jennifer, sending a prayer of thanksgiving for all who assisted Mom Carol and me during Mom's journey to finally be with the Lord. We are so grateful for all the angels that surround us on the journey. From Ophelia, please pray for my brother-in-law, George, in the ICU. And Linda Maloney also echoing the loss of Miss Nancy for both the Butler and Yates families. Thank you, and praise be to God. All right. I'm going to spring something on you. Would somebody like to lead us in prayer this morning? Anyone? You just unmute yourself and pray. I'm going to call on somebody. I'm going to do it. All right. Linda Maloney, would you lead us in prayer?
Good morning again, everyone. Please bring us all together, Father God, and know that we are a blessed people to be your people, to have one another, to be in fellowship, to disagree, to love one another through it all, for all those who care for one another, who comfort one another, who provide health care and food and shelter and encouragement and inspiration, who give calls and send up prayers, who stop by people's houses, who deliver gifts, who just touch us in so many ways. We are all a family, a body of Christ, and in any way that we can, let us show our love for one another, for this church, for each and every member. Send forth your comfort to those who have lost loved ones, the Butler and Yates families, the Becky Price and loss of her husband, so many others that we don't even know their names, Father God, but you know each and every soul that you have brought home to be with you. And we say thank you for their transition and ask your comfort over those who have been left behind to mourn their loss. Lord God, just touch us, heal us, be with us in mind, body, and in spirit, and let us continue to work together, walk together, to commune together, and love one another. As your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, did so long ago, he led us to you. Mm-hmm. And by his grace, by his mercy, by his blood that he shed, we are reconciled with you. Thank you, Father God, for this day, for this fellowship, for my church family, for my neighborhood and my family and my friends. Thank you for my healing, Father God.
Yeah.
I lift all this up in the precious name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Linda. We need to pray for one another, and it doesn't always have to be the pastor doing it. I think it means a lot more when somebody other than the pastor does it. Amen. Amen. And what a gifted prayer warrior. So thank you so much. Let's also pray to the Lord in the manner that he taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Thank you for participating in prayer time and for all your prayer requests. I'll go ahead and cue up our closing hymn. It's How Firm a Foundation. One moment, please.
Saints of the Lord is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled.
Omnipotent.
Jesus doth lean for repose. I will not desert to its foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
Amen. Go from this place knowing that God is in control, that God will see you through whatever our future holds, that God will send angels that you can rely on when you are at your weakest. Go forth to serve God and neighbor in everything that you do, in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, I'm going to go ahead and unmute everyone. Have a great and blessed day.
You too.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning,
everyone. Let's say good afternoon.
It's our time.
Have a great week, everyone.
Have a great week. Have a great week. Miss and love you all.
Miss you guys too.
Miss you too.
Someday.
Good morning, everyone. This is Gloria.
Good morning.
Hi, Gloria.
Hey, Gloria.
Got on.
Good morning. Good. Keeping well.
Hey, that's on your lovely.
Yeah. You're your week, everyone.
Yeah, it's all awesome on everyone. So.
He was on.
Hi, Daddy.
Nice, everyone. Oh. See you again. Yeah, so you know, are you there?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good morning.
Daddy's on the call, too.
Are you there?
Yes.
Hey, Lawson.
Yeah. Hi.
How are you doing?
It's cool.
Good
morning. Good morning. Good morning. All of your smiling faces.
Somebody set it up for him. B. Cooper, it says.
Hey, Jim, I'll check the safe, see what's in there.
I just counted everything Fridays.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
He is our counting angel.
I thought this would be over by now.
I'm sorry, Sarah.
Hey, Sarah. I'm Sarah. Hi, here's Sarah.
Hey, Marilyn.
Hey, Gloria.
Hey, how are you doing?
Gloria.
Good. Good to hear your voice.
Great.
Oh, shit. I'll see you guys on Wednesday.
Wednesday and Thursday, guys. Wednesday and Thursday.
Susan Carroll, blessings to you at this time.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. God bless you.
Have a blessed week, everyone.
Have a good week.
You too, Sandra.
Bye, guys. Later.
All right. All right, everybody. Have a wonderful week. See you next week. Same time, same place.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.
Good week.
Bye. Bye. Hello, everybody. This is Sandra.
Hi, Sandra.
I want to thank you all for all your prayers. My sister and my brother-in-law are doing great. They went out for a ride yesterday, and they slammed Corona. Praise God for the blessing.
Good. May God continue to bless everyone till we're able to meet again. Yes, amen.
Susan, did you already give the details of Nancy's memorial service?
No, I didn't give anything. If you want to do it,
okay. It will be next Saturday. From Barrier Queen, and they will stream the service. We can only have 10 people there, but they will stream it live, and they will also have it available on their website. So as soon as we get the information to send out, we will send you whatever we can give you to link to that.
All the information will eventually be up on the Barrier Queen website. That's still working. It's hard to close out 95 years of a very full Good. Okay, well, everybody have a great day and enjoy the weather coming up. We have a couple good days, so enjoy. Take care. Bye-bye.
I'll see you later.
Bye. Bye. Have a good week, everyone.
Thanks.
Great week. Love you all. Miss you all.
Yeah.
Me too.
Right. Take care.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Now.
Daddy, you still on?
He's wide awake, Kathleen.
Right. Yeah, I can. Can you see me?
I can see you.
I can't see you because I didn't get onto Zoom. So
yeah, we have to get you onto it, Miss Gloria.
But I did after the fact watching YouTube.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Pastor Lem.
And April, sorry, still I'm muted. You're welcome.
That little boy is doing wonderful.
Yes, he is.
All right, yes. Folks, I'll see you later.
All right, love you.
Take care.
Daddy, you Daddy, I'll call you later, okay?
Thank you.
All right.
Me too.
Yes, all right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, Pastor. Talk to you Bye-bye. Later.
Take it easy.
Oh, Pastor, I have a question.
Yeah, yeah.
So in, you know, in being in the house more, I'm finding clothes that I don't wear. Mm. I know that we were doing like a drive before for the Evening Stars. Is it going to be anybody ever in the building to bring, like if I had a bag, maybe in the next couple of weeks, I'll just follow up to see if I can bring some stuff.
Yes, you can certainly bring them by. For my part, I'm usually in there with my son, usually the Wednesdays and the Fridays. Sometimes Gigi, very rarely, will be there on Tuesday mornings, but I think you'd be safe leaving it maybe like on a Wednesday morning or something like that. I probably won't come to the door. You can either leave it in front of the door and then I can just bring it on the inside or whatever.
Okay.
But I'll let Gigi know once you've dropped that stuff off. I don't know what her plans for it all will be, but maybe I can talk to her about it, figure out like where we can send some of that stuff. I know that in the city we have what do they call it? Susanna Wesley House. Sometimes they need clothes for folks like that to kind of like do business interviews and things like that. So
Right. Okay. Okay, well, yeah, give me a couple weeks, but I'm starting to get things together. So I was just wondering. And Miss Gloria was too. I don't know if she's still in the call. I have to let her know that's an option too.
Okay.
Okay. Perfect. All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, talk to you later. Bye-bye. Daddy, love you. See you later.
Okay, hi.
Okay, see you, Pastor. All right. Bye-bye.
They're all in their houses talking on their phone. Somebody in the house next door.
Yeah, I'm talking to everybody.
So I guess they're finished.
You want your watermelon
now? No.
You want to put it in the fridge?
All right, folks, I show 6 remaining participants on the call and not hearing anybody else. I'm going to go ahead and end the meeting for everyone. Thank you again for joining us for worship, and God bless you. Have a great week. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.